There's no getting away from it. It's impossible to walk through the town by yourself. It's safe, when we hear this now, if you walk through the town, you get beaten up. You've got to walk around in at least two and threes. The same goes with the other crew, say the skinheads. Otherwise you just get beaten up. You've got to look after yourself.
Any young people today are causing problems and causing vandalism and hooliganism. They're doing it because they want to be noticed. There's no doubt about that in my mind at all. They'll create gangs, they'll create murders to be noticed, to show the public, to tell the public, look, you're not providing all the things we want. We want to have a bit of fun. We want a bit of danger. We want a bit of the hazards of life.
A new Newcastle, reshaped, remodeled for the future, with a shiny, polished face of office blocks and neat housing estates. The slum areas are disappearing as the planners scheme to give the young the flavour of a new life. But as it's grown, so have violence and terror in the streets. Violent crime has soared by 17% in the past year, and it's there, in the streets, around the corner. But for the occasional newspaper headline, many have no idea that the new way of life has bred a new way of violence. At the bottom of the garden, in our own backyard. Of course, a vast proportion of the young have benefited from the new social deal. But the numbers of teenagers involved in mob vandalism and street terrorism are by no means insignificant. Gangs of youth, some of them 100 strong, roam the city. To them, violence means survival. It's excitement, and it's become instinctive. Street battles flourish as the young people flock to one flag or the other, skinheads against hairies. Two distinct and bitterly opposed groups. Skinheads like the Scotswood Aggro Boys on the one hand, with their uniform styles of checked shirts, big polished boots, crombie overcoats, and close-cropped hairstyles, grown slightly longer for the winter. Many proud of their headline reputation for violence, and anxious to exaggerate their toughness. They group on street corners. They're younger, many of them still at school, so they can't afford much in the way of social activities, but they do have their own type of music. It's an almost puritanical outlook. They've adopted the skinhead uniform, they say, because it's tidy, the hair short, because it's clean. And they strongly disapprove of drugs, beads, and other hippie-style adornments. The Hairies, groups like the Throckley Mob, are older and can afford to base themselves in a discotheque or take over a pub if it plays their kind of music. They have cars or motorbikes, see themselves as part of the new young elite, the generation which everyone is telling them has it made. Some of them admit to taking drugs. So the rivals exist side by side in Newcastle in dedicated opposition. But how extreme is their code of violence?
Put it this way, they would give us a really walking hour, hiding and all that, so we'd do the same to them.
You know, there's bottles, knives, you'll nail it, they'll use them. The same with us, we'll use them on them as well. Once there's a fight, you know, it's a proper fight. Everything goes in it. And you don't count the odds when it's happening, you just get in and fight.
Well, if somebody dies, I think it's going to be a skinhead force because it's the Hairies who are carrying the guns.
You know, everything happens. I'm not saying shotguns, but everything goes into it if there's a fight.
You don't arm yourselves at all, then?
No, not with guns, anyway. Well, cushions, no. Well, he cushed the black bone you don't eat there.
The pull flick knife shooting or mid cleavers and... Or use all, you know, milk bottles, cushions, pub bottles, you name it, they use it, like.
The lasses as well. Him? And they started about with two skinny lasses I met one night. And they took this meat knife off them. What was it like? It was like that, a meat knife. The girls were carrying. When it's a fight and a cop has come, all the weapons disappear, the girls walk away. The girls have got the weapons. That night, two girls, a meat knife like that. And this would be used in a fight. There's too much violence, there's no need for it.
Of course, when trouble does break out, it's the police who've got to deal with it. So they, more than anyone, know just how extensive the violence actually is. The Assistant Chief Constable is Walter Bahari.
Well, the problem in Newcastle is the same as what's happening in most cities of that size throughout the country, that this wave of violence and hooliganism seems to be spreading, we are finding that hooliganism is taking place in the main for no apparent reason. It seems to be a form of amusement or pleasure to the boys that are concerned in it.
Some of the guns wrong, skinnies have done it. It's not the langhead ones, it's the house of skinnies. They run after you, man. They get the blame for everything.
The law hates them. They do, they hate the Hairies. They can't stand it. And they get all this patter on the telly about the skinheads. But really, all they're doing is clamping down on the Hairies. They don't care the monkeys about the skinheads because they know they're just kids.
Yes. Everybody's yes. Getting it with. Everybody. The chase while out of the tune, you can't go and do the tune for the newer. The coppers been behind you. You're always run away from coppers, man.
As you often find delinquents, kids saying, well, you know, people are pushing us around, they won't let us alone, they're on our backs the whole time. This is why we react like this.
Dr. Stanley Cohen of Durham University, a sociologist who's made a close study of teenage violence.
When in the type of housing estates, in the urban areas like this, a delinquency problem develops, particularly if it takes the form of violence, the initial reaction by the press and the public and by the police is justifiably to see this as a threatening problem, something they have to do something about, something very special. So very often, a lot of public anxiety, public attention is directed to these specific areas. It's a tense situation. Everybody's on the lookout for who's carrying a weapon, who's going to jostle somebody, who's going to knock somebody over, which gangs are fighting tonight, what's going to happen tonight. Now, in this situation, there's an edge of tension that the slightest incident will provoke a reaction by the police. And the kid's reaction when this incident happens, even though he might have provoked it himself, he might have deliberately gone out of his way to cause trouble, his reaction is typically, well, why do they pick on me? Everybody's doing this. Everybody in the area is behaving this way. Why did the police come and choose me for this?
Dr. Cohen's theory is that it's the design and drab uniformity of housing estates that are partly to blame, because they make little or no concession to the needs of young people. And in the older areas, it's more simply bad housing and sheer poverty. It's a theory that's borne out by the police.
We're getting at either end of the city where the large housing estates are housing the poorer type of family. We're getting widespread vandalism in the council properties. Schools, flats and so on are being broken up. We're getting complaints from elderly people living in flats in council estates of terrorism, in the sense that many old people are afraid to come out at night. And indeed in some parts are afraid also to report these things, otherwise they get victimized by youthful gangs.
And housing conditions and bad social planning are a part answer to the problem that entertainer Frankie Vaughan's been tackling during his many years' work as president of the National Association of Boys Clubs.
Well, the biggest problem of recent years was the problem I came up against at Easter House in Glasgow. This was an overspill area where they built a whole area without any consideration to what young people would get to doing, you know, without any consideration for their sort of activities in life. Young people need areas where they can have a bit of fun, a bit of romance, a bit of adventure. And this was a problem that grew and grew until the kids got so bored that they decided to have their own adventures, and they created gangs which became the most violent gangs in the history of Scotland. In fact, I did warn authorities that it would happen around Glasgow, in Scotland, it would happen in England, in areas where they built new towns without any consideration for young people.
The Scotswood Aggro Boys were brought up in this run-down area of Tyneside. Many have seen their home, their entire street, demolished, and they've been moved to the newer outlying estates. but they still feel that they belong to Scotswood and travel down there every night to meet up. And this identification with their area has led to the theory that the skinhead daubings are really territorial boundaries within which they rule supreme. Doesn't everyone, though, have the right to walk freely about the streets?
No, it's the same when we see we going up the west end of the city where Big Lamb ruling all that.
We can't go
they would see the same notes we were walking through and they'd go ahead.
So you must go out of your area to have a battle?
We've got there, they're not come down here. We haven't had a battle on ground.
So you admit you go out looking for a battle?
Aye, well, this day.
Well, why do you do
well,
this?
Well, because we're legging, we're leg fights.
It breeds of itself in that you might have a gang of skinheads who want to cause trouble somewhere and they pick on some other boys. They in turn form a gang and look after themselves. We get boys picked up for carrying offensive weapons. Their story, of course, always is that they carry these because they need them to protect themselves.
But self-defense, I've got no conscience about self-defense. We aren't going to back down from them. We aren't going to see a peace in all this. They've just cut right through us. The police don't help in any way, you know, so we've got to take it on myself to handle it.
You have kids going around in a fairly large group, in which each one of them is not necessarily committed to behave violently that evening, but each one thinks that the other one expects him to behave in that way. And so in order not to be shown up in front of all the crowd, in order not to be shown up in front of the people whose respect he needs, he will behave in the way that he thinks other people expect him. And of course everybody else is caught up in this network of fantasy.
Of course, much of their toughness is sheer fantasy. The Hairies also play out their fantasies on their bikes and find escapism in drugs.
It's real class, sort of like having a few joints, you know, and just jumping on your bike, really blasting on, you know, your head spinning, and you know, you're not sort of like stunned on your mind, not like drinking, you know what you're doing all the time, it's a really good feeling. And, acid, you know, LSD, that's really class stuff, that, you know, the hallucinations you get, it's really spot on, you know, someone had the snakes chasing you, that works. Oh yeah, I feel great, really, like, you know, when it's only about 100 men and all. And the fear, you know, when somebody pulls out in front of you and you say, oh my God, I want to hit him. And the fear that guns throw your back, you know, you get off shaking, really shaking, like. The pigs, I mean, the police, you know, they've got a grudge against everybody, haven't they? You know, they hate everybody, they don't like anybody that's not a policeman. And the way we drive, like, couldn't give a damn about them. As long as I didn't catch you already, just look around and see there's no policeman there. And just drive like hell. People think, everybody was going down the street like that. But I think they're a bit jealous. Because they haven't got bikes like this, like the way we have, you know. And we drive, you know, crazy. And I like people to look around at me and say, my God, look at him. He's crazy. But I like people to say that, you know, I like to see the expressions on their faces. They really are jealous, you know, because they haven't got bikes they are.
When you go to a pop festival, you're looking for something different. You don't really know what to expect. You know, you can expect anything. It's not like a football match. You go to a football match and the most exciting thing that ever happens is that everybody gets hit by a bottle. You know, but pop festivals, each one's different. You just don't know what to expect. You
But for the skinheads, it's the match, the Saturday afternoon game at St. James Park, or a trip to see Newcastle play away, if they can find a coach operator who will take them. Skinhead violence and football have tended to become synonymous in recent seasons. The sport's become an excuse for trouble, although Newcastle's police have succeeded with their special match tactics. Plenty of men, panda cars and dogs in evidence in the city to deter any would-be troublemakers. The high-rise flats look over St. James Park. symbolizing the sociologist's theory that housing plays its part in the problem. But Dr. Cohen believes that it's got its roots in most aspects of the teenagers' lives, even to their schools.
The teacher wields an authority that they don't respect. The teacher's trying to teach them about things that they don't want to have anything to do with. As soon as they can, as soon as they are able to legally, they want to leave school. Jobs don't matter. Excitement, autonomy, fulfillment, all the things that the mass media are saying that you should be able to get, all the values that the advertisements are stressing, getting ahead, buying this car, and if you buy this car, you'll be able to have this girl and you'll be able to live this exciting life. All these things that are stressed in the mass media and have been stressed in teenage culture since the middle of the 1950s. And this, I think, leaves them in a position which is roughly like somebody who's watching a race, a race around a track, where he really feels he just is not playing that, he's not in that race at all. He doesn't want to compete, he's got no chance of winning, even if he did want to compete. And so his response is, well, I'll throw a stone at the person who is winning, or I'll shoot the starter, or I'll get off the track. And I think this is what violence is about.
Up until now, the authorities' main contribution has been to build youth clubs. But several of these have been forced to close anyway because of the extent of the violence. And even in areas where the teenagers want them, are enough being built?
No. We definitely want a club built here. I tell you what, we're going to all of the clubs like West End, New Big and all that. Anybody from Scotch's band, from this area, the board, nobody can get in.
Except Million.
And
the board is from there as well?
That's a canny distance to go.
I'm very critical of youth clubs. I'm very critical of authorities that think by just sticking up a youth club and saying, here's a magnificent youth club, that get on with it, that's it. That isn't it at all.
And that's why to talk in terms of solving the problem by building more youth clubs or getting these kids to go and play ping pong in a youth club or climb Mount Snowdon and get the Duke of Edinburgh Awards is, you know, just totally irrelevant. It's just not part of their life.
Family units are more important than boys' clubs and girls' clubs and youth clubs put together. But, of course, it's not possible for families today to provide all the good things in life at the same time, provide love and affection for their own. I'm afraid it's a mess, society, at the moment. We've got to study our own home, and then study our leisure time, and then study opportunities for kids to let off their inhibitions in a proper atmosphere.
We're finding that very few parents are really concerned as to what their boys do. Some of them are concerned, some of them take steps to sort the matter out. But others, I'm afraid, do not cooperate with the police. If we approach them, they don't really care. And the basic thing is, I think that some of the parents don't even care what happens to their children anyway.
Geordie is one of the Scotswood boys who is lucky enough to have parents who do care. But do even his parents know just what happens, say, at a football match?
Oh, well, with that fella, you know, just like that, I'm getting trouble with the police, like, you know.
I wish they wouldn't go, because I dread it. Well, it's the innocent, it's them matches that gets hurt, I think. You know, when bottle thrown, and these bad groups, the skinheads, the pick fights with the guns, and some of these lads, they're that decent, they'll turn their back, but the bad ones will not, you know. Some of the parents must know what's happening. You know, the trouble they're making, and they're bound to come in some states, cut bruises and one thing and another. They just must know what's going on. And as I've often told George, his dad's told George, that if he brings any trouble here, if we see a police at our door, his dad threatens he'll storm off in four walls.
Well, I think myself, if violence was met with violence, that may be an answer, but yes, somehow or other. Something like, instead of a £15 fine, the borch, for example. If a young lad was going to, now he's going to get a half dozen strokes off the borch, he might think twice of using violence himself.
The public generally tends to demand the type of action which, ironically, is often as violent an outlook as the skinhead's own. They call for the return of corporal punishment, the return of national service. But Dr. Cohen's found that there's an endless shifting of responsibility, a limitless buck passing wherever the problem's raised.
I think really what happens when we try to say, well, how do we deal with this problem? You know, what is our society doing about it? Is that the same sort of projection of blame by one onto the other by Hairies onto Skinheads, by Skinheads onto Hairies, by Skinheads onto the police onto Skinheads. This gets reproduced when we try to deal with the problem. The police say, well, our hands are tied behind our backs, people won't let us use the right methods, if only the law would let us operate more freely. The courts say, well, we're doing our job, the police don't operate the law more effectively. Schools say, well, you know, it's not our fault, don't blame us, it's the home that has failed. The parents say, well...
The answer is, the law is not strict enough. Like I said beforehand, the police, the village police itself, he was the man who was the law. And if you saw a police walking down the street and you was there, and you didn't obey the law, for the simple reason was, he used to just say, hey lad, could I do what you know you get? You'll get a good end off me. And that threatened me more than what a 5-pound fine did, I tell you, because that police was a big man. And I'll hit again the bad of him. Well, I think myself now, if the police would just use a little bit more, like a backhander, I think myself, if the police give him a backhander, I wouldn't dispute the police.
And so you get reproduced on society, on the level of the whole of society, this projection of blame and responsibility from one authority to the other.
But when there's no one left to blame, it's the police they all fall back on. Even though they're undermanned, they've started to put policemen back on the beat, and more in evidence than the panda car flashing past every half hour or so. But even so, their job isn't easy.
Our hands are tied in many of these things, because the weapons they carry are normally ordinary, everyday things. We've not had much in the way of organized weapons in the sense of firearms and so on. We do get knives, we get bicycle chains, knuckle dusters, hammers, any kind of thing which is an ordinary everyday household thing which is carried.
They come around this corner, they jump with the van, and all you see is shotguns, bayonets and all sorts aimed at you.
Why do you carry sawn off shotguns?
Oh, just to shoot off, eh? No, I just to shoot off. See, okay, they got picked up, you know. That's about 5'10".
It's not even safe on public transport. British Rail have faced big repair bills and they've put policemen on some late night trains because of the threat to passengers. A local journalist, Alan Steen, witnessed one incident when a gang of 80 skinheads took over a compartment and viciously terrified an old lady.
The lad who was being particularly offensive to this old lady did ask her whether she masturbated and assured her that he did, although his mother didn't like it very much. And then he knocked her shopping bag onto the floor. And when she protested, he just kicked it out of her way. This was when it was really beginning to become ugly, but fortunately the police moved in very quickly after that.
Everyone likes to cherish the idea that he'd be able to put a stop to a situation like this, but Alan Steen found he could do nothing when faced with the mob. He pretended to read a book.
I'd always thought if something like this happened, I would in fact get up and sort them out in some way at least, but when it actually did happen, I couldn't do anything about it. I just sat there. Something that made me very ashamed of myself. I couldn't do anything about it.
We would like the public to be rather chary as to how they come into this, because very often this is precisely what the gang wants. They want trouble, they're set off to find trouble, and some member of the public who tries to stop them, of course, becomes involved in the trouble.
Hate lawmen. That's the main problem in our lawmen. Hairies, second. Black Bones, we hate them. We hate the big lamp. Hate writing. Hating nearly all the crews, New Biggin, we hate New Biggin. Now they hate us, you know what I mean?
But why? What have they done to you?
No, they've done out, but we've got a better name, you know what I mean? We're hard of us. We've got loads of little young ones following up, man, you know what I mean? They'll always be skinny to do here.
But this can't go on forever, can it? I mean, what's going to happen when you're 21, 22?
Well, it's young ones like this, what have carried it on?
Plenty behind me.
Skinheads will disappear. There are signs of that already. A new trend will replace it, and the gangs could continue under different names, but in the same areas. Biker, Wallsend, Wrighton, Walker, Westerhope, Newbiggin Hall, Kenton, Benwell, and of course, Scotswood. Or will the children somehow escape the apparent inevitability of it all?
No one knows what it's like to be the bad man, to be the sad man, behind the blue eyes. No one knows what it's like to be hated, to be faded, to telling only lies. But my dreams, they aren't as empty as my conscience seems to be. I have hours only lonely. My love is vengeance that's never free. It's like to feel these feelings like I do, and I blame you. No one bites back as hard on their anger. None of my pain and woe can show through.
If we could persuade the youngsters concerned that they're doing themselves an injury, in the sense that if they have convictions like this as they grow older, they're to be ostracized by society, because whether they like it or not, society is as it is, and whether they change it, it will still remain that somebody has got to be able to walk about the streets safely.
Now, most people would say that what I'm doing is making excuses. The reaction is that I'm letting people off the hook, letting them off moral blame. They'll also probably say, at the very making of films like this is unnecessary, is useless, is in fact dangerous, because paying attention to these sort of problems somehow seem to glorify violence, to put attention onto something which should be brushed aside. Now, but it is people like us, and I'm not just talking about people who have the luxury of sitting back at looking at the problem from university lectureships, but people in the street, police, magistrates, members of the public, have to really try and understand. It's their job. And the one thing that they've never done in the past is just simply to look and to listen. And if they listened to what the kids said, I don't think they would make the same mistakes that they have in the past.